So let's pray together, and we'll start with Zechariah chapter 4. Father, thank you for my sisters here. Thank you for the ones who meet tonight to hear your word. Thank you for these who have set aside time to study this strange and ancient book called Zechariah. Thank you for this young man who was given dreams and visions beyond his capacity to humanly understand. Thank you for sending messengers, interpreting angels, even the angel of the Lord to guide him. Thank you that you were reading Zerubbabel's mail. You were understanding his thoughts and fears, and you cared enough to send messages of encouragement, pictures and words for him so that he could complete the task that you had assigned for him to do. So, Lord, thank you for being a God who speaks, a God who listens, a God who cares, a God who is intimate and personal, and a God who picks up and carries us in everything that you call us to do. Thank you for being a God like that. And we worship and honor you today, and we ask you to speak to us. We're right where we are, just like you did with Zerubbabel, that you would speak to us through your word, by your Holy Spirit, and encourage us today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So if you have joined us just this week, remember we're in the Old Testament book of Zechariah. It's 14 chapters long. It's the most major of the minor prophets. And so Zechariah is speaking to the part of Israel known as Judah, the southern two tribes. They have just returned from their captivity in Babylon, 70 years, where God sent them to be held captive in a strange and alien land. For the multiplication of all of the sins that they had committed against him. And so that captivity was like a time of discipline and a time of testing for them. And then God miraculously released them in three different deportations back to the land of Israel, back to his place, back to Jerusalem. And Zechariah is a young man at this time. He's probably in his early to mid-20s, and he's prophesying. He's a seer, and he's a prophet. So he sees visions, and he also speaks the word of the Lord. And he and Haggai, who's quite a bit older, are speaking roughly at the same time to the same group of people about the same thing, which was rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem. The next deportation comes Ezra, he rebuilds the people, and the last deportation comes Nehemiah, and he rebuilds the walls of the city. So that's how it all fits together. God starts with his own house first. Contrary to the people of Israel who had come back, they started with their own houses first. They laid the temple foundation in Ezra chapter 3, and there was all kinds of celebration, and then they stopped. Because the task was too large and the enemies were too numerous, and they got distracted and discouraged by the bigness of what God had called them to do, and so they stopped. And Haggai says, how can you make for yourself a paneled house when God just has a foundation right there? And Zechariah comes along, he's a tad more positive, and he has these strange visions that happen all in one night, February 15th, around 519 BC. And he has a series of eight visions, and we're at the crux of the visions today. We're in the fifth vision in chapter 4, and it's the vision of the gold lampstand and the two olive trees. So on your table, there's a note sheet for you so that you can take whatever notes you want to put on there. I've left some blanks in there. I hope I fill them all. Just raise your hand if I don't adequately say what needs to go in the blank. And then there's two pictures. I made enough copies, not for everybody, but there are copies of two renderings of what this vision may have looked like. Remember, there were no selfies back then, no iPhones, so no one's taking pictures of it. This is all that's described, and these are artist renderings of what it may have looked like, and I thought that would just be fun for you to look at something and try to figure out, if you were Zechariah, what would you have thought? It's kind of a little bit weird. All right, so a few weeks ago, I was leaving on vacation. I was going to go lay my mom's ashes to rest. And as I always do, right before I leave, I clean my house. Why do we do that? I don't know. But anyway, yeah, we kind of come home to a clean house, whatever it is. But I got on, you know, one of those times when you really, like, you start something and then you just do everything. It's like you mow everything down. I was potting plants. I took my couch apart and washed all the cushions. Even my dog was looking at me like, lady, what the heck? You know, I mean, I was just flying around in this flurry, and all of a sudden it hit me, I've got to change my air conditioning filter. Now, where that came from, I don't know. Whether that was a word from the Lord. Well, my air conditioning filter is up in my attic, which is above my garage. So, you know, I'm not known for my great height. And so I have to go into my garage, and I have to get on a step stool. So I get on my step stool, I put that up, and I climb up. Of course, I have bad knees, so I'm climbing up on there, and then I pull down the trap door that houses a very heavy wooden ladder. Okay, so then I'm reaching up for the ladder, so I get the ladder, and it comes down really hard, boom, right on my shoulders like that. Now I'm standing there with the filter in my hand, bad knees on a ladder, underneath the heavy wooden rungs of the ladder around my shoulders. I wish I could have taken a picture. I didn't have a free hand to really snap it, but there I was standing there, and I'm thinking, you know, I could die right here. I could fall off here, I could die, I could crack my head. You know, I realized in the moment that I was transitioning from that period of life where you're young enough and getting old enough to say, I need help with things, and I transitioned in that moment on the ladder to somebody's got to do this stuff for me. From now on, somebody's got, one of your husbands is going to have to come to my house and get up on that sad ladder and change my filter. They're going to have to. Somebody has got to do it for me. I've gotten to that place. Have you ever felt like that transition where you're like, okay, up to now, I've been able to kind of do this myself. And maybe I've had a little bit of help, but there's going to be a time when you have to ask somebody to do it for you. It's like going back towards the cradle. You know, when everybody used to do things for you when you were a baby, I can feel it starting to move. There are some things I can't do for myself. My dear friend Kathy, who lives in California, she was given the vision for the Freedom Climb. I've been doing these mountain climbing things to raise money and awareness to combat human trafficking. So far, we've raised over $1 million and set about 7,000 people free all over the world from sex trafficking and rehabilitated them into jobs and homes and all of that. It's been wonderful. We've hiked Kilimanjaro. We've been to Everest Base Camp. This summer, we did 7 summits in 4 days in Colorado, 7 14ers in 4 days. And all of this to combat trafficking. Well, my friend Kathy is the visionary for it. She received the word from the Lord as she was climbing Mount Whitney to conquer her fear of heights, that God was going to call her to call women to climb mountains on behalf of the trafficked. After our climb in July, Kathy came home to her house in Valley Center, California, began to feel a little sick. And as would have it, she has pancreatic cancer. So she's going through this very transition that I went through on the ladder, only in a more serious way. Here's a woman who's 62 years old in the prime of her life with huge vision and huge impact, and she's battling with her first round of chemo right now. And it started on Monday, and now she's going through what that feels like. Well, she sent an email yesterday, and I thought I would read it to you, because if you knew Kathy and how capable she is and how strong she is, and for her to write this, you know how hard it is not to ask for help, but to ask for somebody to do it for you. She wrote this to about 20 of us, friends of hers. She said, the first 3 to 5 days after chemo, I'm not supposed to touch, eat, or drink anything cold because that helps prevent neuropathy. Well, that makes preparing lunch from the fridge a really hard thing to do. And so here's what I want to do. You're someone I could ask, will you make a sandwich or bring me a bowl of soup and not have to tell you which way to get to the fridge? You are one who would help yourself to whatever you want, wherever you want in my house. She's asking 20 friends, not all of the friends she has, but 20 of us who would not have a lot to say, who would know our way around her house, that she could say, will you do this for me? She can't do it herself now. She needs someone to do it for her. And maybe you're not at that place. You know, maybe you're not struggling with cancer, or you're not an old gal with bad knees on a ladder in a garage trying to put a filter in. But somehow in your life, in some part of your life, it's too much. You've asked for help and it hasn't come. Or it's beyond someone else's power to help you. It's you can't keep everybody happy. You can't juggle all the balls anymore. You just can't keep it going. The circus has come to a stop. And you need somebody to do it for you. Not just to help you, but you need somebody to do it for you. So I'm going to suggest it's time to change your filter, okay? Just like you change your air conditioning filter so that the air in your house that gets dirty gets filtered through this filter and then you have clean air. So I'm going to suggest another kind of filter, and we're going to do a Zechariah 4:6 filter today. So we're going to start filtering our thoughts and our lives and our responsibilities and our tasks through this filter, the filter of Zechariah 4:6, and you have it right there at the top of your note sheet, I believe. It says, "Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty." You know that God is reading Zerubbabel's mail, because what does it mean when you start a verse that says, "not by might"? What does God know that Zerubbabel is thinking? He's thinking, if only I could get more people involved, I could get this temple done. If only more people would help me, I could complete this task. Because the word, "not by might," that word "might" means the power of many. It means an army. It means like a multitude of people who are armed and ready to fight. And God says it's not by might. And then he goes on to say it's not by power. So he's reading Zerubbabel's mail and he's saying, Zerubbabel's thinking to himself, if I were only more strong myself, if I were only a better leader, if I only could cast vision better, if I only had these gifts. But the Spirit says it's not by power. That word power means the strength of one person. So it's not by the power or the might of many. It's not by the power of one person. What is it then, Zerubbabel? What is it then? Kathy and Betty and Janine and Joanne, it's by my spirit, says the Lord. That's the filter. Not by might, not by as many people as you can gather around you to help, not by power, not by your own strength and giftedness, but by my spirit, says the Lord. He's the one who says, I don't want to help you, I want to do it for you. I want to do it for you. And this is the message that comes out of the vision. So let's look at the vision. It's an odd little vision, as you will be able to see. So I'm going to read it, and you look at the picture and see, or pictures, and see if you can follow along. So let me read the vision from verse 1. It says, "Then the angel who talked with me returned and woke me up." Now, he wasn't actually sleeping. We're going to know this in the next part of the verse. He was probably, after the first four visions, in like a comatose state. Very exhausted, very like dopey, kind of out of it. And so the spirit, it says, the angel literally stirred him up again. So he wasn't sleeping, but he was stirred up again. Like someone awakened from sleep. And verse 2, he asked me, the angel said, "What do you see?" And I answered, "I see a solid gold lampstand." Underline lampstand, the Hebrew there is menorah, as you know. A menorah is the seven-pronged candlestick that the Jews use. I think now it has eight because of Hanukkah, but the original was seven. And so this would have been common for Zechariah as a priest to see this when he would minister in the holy place. Remember, there was the outer court of the tabernacle and the outer court of Solomon's temple. And then only the priest could go into the holy place, not the holy of holies. That's where the high priest only went in. But the first article of furniture inside the holy place where the priest ministered was this candlestick, the golden candlestick, the golden menorah. And this thing lit the entire holy place. It was the light source for the holy place. And so this would have been common for Zechariah. He would have known what this is. And the priest's job were to trim the wicks of these lamps and to fill them with pure olive oil 3 times a day. It was a laborious job that had to be changed morning, noon, and night so that there would always be light. There was always light inside the holy place. It was never dark. So then verse 2, it says, he asked me, what do you see? And I answered, I see a solid gold lampstand with a bowl at the top. Now, this is the first unique thing, because the 7 candlestick didn't have a bowl at the top. It just had the 7 candlesticks with the lampstand, with the stand. And so this is the first unique feature. There's a bowl at the top and 7 lamps on it, meaning 7 little pipes coming down, or channels coming down from this bowl that connect to these 7 lamps, or these 7 lamp prongs. And so, and the other on its left, I'm sorry, 7 channels, verse 3. Also, there are 2 olive trees by it, one on the right of the bowl and the other on its left. Verse 4, I asked the angel who talked with me, what are these, my Lord? Now, I don't think we quite have the inflection of Zechariah's voice when he saw the 2 olive trees in the middle of the holy place and going, what are these, my Lord? Now, what are living olive trees doing in the middle of the holy place? This is really out of the question as far as Zechariah is concerned. Verse 5, he answered, do you not know what these are? Now, the angel is not saying that to make Zechariah feel stupid that he doesn't know. The angel is actually keeps saying this throughout the vision because he wants Zechariah to know you cannot know the meaning of this without spiritual revelation given from outside of your understanding. And doesn't the Lord do that to us today when we come against hard scriptures or we come against things that need a touch from him to know spiritually what's happening? This is God saying, you don't know what this means because I have to tell you. I'm the one who has to tell you the meaning of this vision. Do you know what these are? No, my Lord, I replied. Zechariah is open to this supernatural revelation. Now the angel does something very interesting. He doesn't give the meaning of the vision. This is the only vision where he doesn't give the meaning. He gives the message that the vision is to convey to Zerubbabel. And that you find in verse 6. And this is the filter that we're using today. Zechariah 4:6. Say it with me. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty. Now, circle the word Almighty. It means Lord of hosts. This is Jehovah Sabaoth. This is the Lord of heaven's armies. This is the one who has all power over all things. So when he says, by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts, this is a power that is unrivaled and unmatched by anything we could conjure up with the power of ourselves or the power of anyone we could gather. There is a power stronger than us that is needed. The point of this vision is not the light. See, the point of the menorah in the holy place is to provide light. The weirdness of this vision, though, is not, it's not about the light. It's about the oil. That's what was fuzzy to Zechariah. He doesn't quite understand. This whole thing about oil and all the pipes going to everything to keep it lit, the point wasn't it being lit and the light it provided. The point was the supply for the light. This is the point of this vision. What is your source of supply? Who is doing it for you? The menorah was all about the light. It seems that God is all about the oil. The whole idea of this is that Zerubbabel faces a task that only God can do. To rebuild that temple, he got the foundation down. But to figure out that temple, even though it was not going to be as grand as Solomon's temple, had to take the Spirit of the Lord to do it for him, to do it through him. He couldn't do it on his own. No human agency could complete the temple. Zerubbabel has someone to do it for him. He has someone. He just doesn't know that the Spirit of God is the one who wants to do it for him. Zerubbabel doesn't know yet, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord Almighty. He doesn't know that yet. It's coming to Zechariah. Can you imagine when Zechariah tried to draw for Zerubbabel what he saw? You won't believe it, Zerubbabel, what the Lord told me to tell you. I got to draw this picture. Oh my gosh, it's so weird. It looks nothing like I've seen in the temple. Because Zerubbabel's not been inside the holy place. He doesn't know what the menorah looks like. Can you imagine Zechariah trying to draw this on a napkin? You know? But the whole point of it, Zerubbabel, what the Lord told me to tell you, is that it's not by the power of many, and it's not by your own giftedness and your own personal strength. It's by the Spirit of the Lord that this will get done. How encouraging must that have been? How encouraging must that have been? Okay, so we're not Zerubbabel, and we're not building a temple. So what in the world does Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6 mean to us today? The first thing I can tell you, this is not on your notes, is that this is probably the clearest verse in the Old Testament on the person and work of the Holy Spirit. You could take this verse out of Zechariah chapter 4, and you could put it anywhere in Paul's writings. You could put it anywhere in John's writings. You could put it anywhere in the New Testament. You could put, Jesus could have said this. He basically said it. Jesus said in John chapter 7, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water, using the water analogy instead of the oil, but the same idea. This life of Jesus through the Holy Spirit, it says, and when he said these things, he was speaking of the Spirit. This is an inner life. This is someone who lives inside you, who lives to do things for you, through you. This is not something that they knew in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit would come upon people, but this idea that it's not by your own strength and not by power, but the Holy Spirit doing it for you is quite unique. It's almost new covenant. And I love that. I love that. But let me apply it three ways, and let's do the filter and use it in three distinct occurrences that appear in the rest of the chapter, okay? So I have them on your note sheet for you, that you use the Zechariah filter whenever you face an obstacle that seems like a mountain. When you face an obstacle that seems like a mountain. Now, maybe that's laundry at home for you. I don't know. Could be as simple as that. Especially if your kid was at the middle school retreat, you're probably still underneath all that laundry. You know, it doesn't matter how simple it is. Sometimes things feel like a mountain. I've had depression, and it feels like a mountain. I would sit in my office when I was going through depression probably 15 years ago, and I looked outside, and everything looked like three times larger than it actually was. I felt like I couldn't move. Like everything, the smallest task was like insurmountable to me. Maybe you feel that. Maybe you've experienced depression and you know exactly what that feels like. Grief has felt like that to me in this last year after my mom's death. Right now, what feels like a mountain to me is this mission week that's coming up. Oh my gosh, we have to raise over $1 million in like 4 days. And I feel that. I know I'm taking that on myself. I'm looking at it as a mountain that I'm responsible to do. And I've thought these exact thoughts Zerubbabel was thinking. If only I could get everybody at Bentry bought in. Like it's my job. Like I'm going to be able to do that. Or if only I was a better leader. If only I was more this or more that or less this and less that. If only I had better ideas and more creative ideas. If only I was tall, thin, and blonde. That's always my default. Then this would be great. See, I do the same thing Zerubbabel was doing because it seems like a mountain to me. This is the 10th year we've been doing the mission week under my leadership. It's not like I've never done it before. And it always works out. God's people are always generous. Everybody, it's always a great week. But somehow this year, for whatever reason, I can't quite figure it out. It just seems like I am looking at the biggest mountain. Are you there today? Maybe it's a mountain of relationship. Maybe it's a mountain of financial ruin or bills, credit card bills, that look like a huge mountain. Maybe it's like Kathy and you're struggling with health or grief or divorce or death or whatever it is, a wayward child, a kid that just went to college and you can't quite get your feet from under you. You're so sad. I don't know what looks like a mountain to you, but Zechariah 4:6 is still your filter. Verse 7 says, "What are you, mighty mountain?" This is the Lord speaking. "What are you, mighty mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you will become level ground. I urge you." I'm going to do this to myself, with myself, with the Lord. Whatever it is that you think is a mountain, speak to it and say, "Before me, you will become level ground." That's what the Lord's doing with Zerubbabel. Tell him that before him, this thing that looks like a mountain, this mighty mountain, whatever it is you fill in the blank, it's going to become level ground. I'm going to flatten it. The trouble is when we speak those words, we think God's going to do that in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, flat. Unfortunately, it doesn't always work within our time frame, but God will have his way with that mountain. He will. It's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. By the Spirit's power, obstacles, and here are some of the obstacles and get in the way, that here are some of the mountains that Zerubbabel faced that we face. Sometimes it's the task at hand. Whatever that thing is, it just looks like a mountain. Sometimes it's the opposition that's against us, people, and their ugly things they say and the ugly things that they do, the hurtful things. Sometimes it's our own sad responses, our discouragement, our lack of faith, our whatever it is. Sometimes our own responses get in the way. Sometimes we're ugly right back. Sometimes our own responses get in the way. We become, just like the Israelites, discouraged, distracted, sidelined. So much so that it's 15 years since they laid that foundation and no work has happened. They're feathering their own nests and leaving God without a home. I don't know what, but God will have his way with this mountain. Because he says, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. What is a mountain next to the Spirit's power? A mountain can overwhelm me. A mountain can overwhelm a multitude of us, but a mountain cannot overwhelm the Spirit of God. Whatever your mountain is today, it will be leveled. I can't tell you when. I can't even tell you how. But I can tell you who. That's the answer. We always look for the how and the you know, when. Like, when, Lord, and how are you going to do it? And we like to tell him those things. I'd like to have this way, wrapped in this package at this time. We often even ask why. And God often doesn't give us the answer to those things. He says, ask the who question and stay there because you know the answer to that question, and that's Jesus. It's his power, and he can flatten any mountain. It goes on to say, then he will bring out the capstone. The capstone was the last piece. This is a prediction of completion. Then he will bring out the capstone. This is Zerubbabel. To shouts of God bless it, God bless it. Your translation may say grace, grace. Some of the questions say beauty, beauty. It's the shout of people that say it's completed, it's done. The capstone is in. In Ezra chapter 6, when the temple was completed, because it was completed in Zerubbabel's day, the people danced with great joy. In fact, the word shout here is the word for thunder in the book of Job. There was such thunderous joy at the completion of this house that the noise was like thunder. Verse 8, then the word of the Lord came to me. Verse 9, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this temple. His hands will also complete it. Then you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me to you. Imagine Zerubbabel hearing this from the Lord. God saw that he completed the foundation. God saw that. So when the prophet comes to him and says, this is what the Lord said to me. The foundation was laid by the hand of Zerubbabel. God saw that. Do you know God sees what you do? God sees what you do. And then it says, not only will his hand not only had he laid the foundation, but God said, your hand, Zerubbabel, will complete this temple. It happened historically. This prophecy was fulfilled in the day of Zerubbabel. So many prophecies are for the future. This prophecy was for then, in that moment. In Zerubbabel's lifetime, he saw the completion of the temple. In fact, Ezra chapter 6 said, Darius the king paid for it. The Israelites didn't even have to pay for it the way God did it. The way God leveled this mountain is that the Persians paid for it, and the people, it said in the Bible, did it quickly. It was completed after a 15-year lapse. And the people shouted with joy. Imagine Zerubbabel hearing, if God says I'm going to complete it, I guess I better get busy. God said, not only is it not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord, but when you live, Zerubbabel, with that filter, your hand that started this thing, you'll complete it. You'll complete it. God can flatten any mountain. He can level it. Because it's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. No pile of laundry, no bad relationship, no credit card amount, no brokenness or death, grief or pain, disease can stand in the way of God's purposes. Because he not only works in this life, you see, God works in the life to come. He is not bound by time. We see this answered historically, but we also know that Jesus is building another temple, it says in 1 Peter, and that temple is full of living stones, and that's you and me and everyone else who comes to Christ around the world are being built into this holy temple. So this temple is just reminiscent. It's a picture of this spiritual temple that's being erected. See, God works in time and eternity. He has all of that to work with. That's why the when question is irrelevant unless he calls the day. And the why question is irrelevant because we do not know, because we often need supernatural revelation, just like Zechariah, to know what things mean. That's why the how question is irrelevant, because we can't even dream that Darius would pay for the temple of the living God to be rebuilt. Who would have ever? No one could have figured that out. That's why the only relevant question when we face a mountain is who? Who? My Jesus. The Spirit, the living God. He's the one in my corner. He's the mountain flattener. I know if I were with Baptist ladies, there'd be an amen in there somewhere. I just know it. But I know I'm with Bible church ladies, so we don't do that kind of stuff. So, thank you. Grace, grace, beauty, beauty, whatever it says in your translation, is the only response when your work is done by the Spirit of God. When you look back, if God does something in time, not just eternity, but in time, and that capstone is put in that situation and it's resolved, the only right response is to look at that thing and say, grace, grace, beauty, beauty, glory, glory. Because God did that, not by my might, not by my power, but by his Spirit, God. The next way or reason you would use a Zechariah 4:6 filter is when you question your own significance. When you question your own significance, not only when you look at something and it appears to be a mountain or seems too big for you, but when you question your own significance. Look at verse 10. It says, "Who dare despise the day of small things?" There's a famous verse for you. Who dares despise the day of small things, since the seven eyes of the Lord that range throughout the earth will rejoice when they see the chosen capstone in the hand of Zerubbabel. God, who is pictured by the seven eyes, seven is the number of perfection It's the omniscience and omnipresence of the Lord. He sees it all. His eyes are everywhere. He knows all. He sees all. He does all. God rejoiced in the day that that temple was completed. Not only were the people rejoicing in Ezra chapter 6, but God, if he jumps up and down and goes, wahoo, that's what he was doing in heaven. He rejoiced at the completion of that temple. Now remember in Ezra chapter 3, when the foundation was laid and the people saw what that was going to be like, the sound of the weeping and the sound of the rejoicing were indistinguishable. They met each other in the middle because some people remembered the glory of the former temple and some people looked at this Zerubbabel temple, what it was going to look like, and they're like, there's no way it's going to be as glorious. And so the rejoicing was mixed. But when this temple was completed, this verse says God rejoiced. God rejoiced on the day that this small thing, this inglorious thing was completed. There are some of you in this room who think, Lord, you have your great people, and then you have me. And I'm sort of like down on the list in the fine print. I don't really do anything for you. I don't accomplish anything for you. I'm not a great person. I'm just kind of like a average to below average kind of Christian, and I struggle. And I know you really love Ann Graham Lotz, and I know you really love Beth Moore, and I know you really love those people, and I wish I could be like that, but I'm just me. I'm a small thing. We have all thought that at one time or another. Some of us are in the habit of thinking that on a regular basis, and I'm here to tell you that God has a long history of using small things. Because small things in the hand of a big God make a huge difference. I'll just give you a few examples. You know, God used Moses' rod, just a stick. God can use a stick. Are you better than a stick? You're not a stick figure, right? So you're gotta be better than a stick. Okay, you're better than that. David's sling. Are you better than that? Are you better than a sling? Are you higher in the order of things than a sling? Yes. Yes, you do know that, don't you?
Yes.
Yes, good, okay. A donkey's jawbone, come on. A donkey's jawbone, you're better than that. A hammer and a tent peg, remember? In the hands of Jael in the Old Testament where she took that Sisera and she coaxed him into her tent and he thought he was going to get all kinds of goodies, and when he fell asleep, she nailed him to the ground through the temple of his head. It's one of those great passages in the Bible. A piece of scarlet rope, remember, in the book of Rahab, when she lets the spies down on that red cord. Loaves and the fish, the cup of cold water. Even Jesus spit on dirt and made mud. God has a long history of using small things, sisters. And you are far from a small thing. You are far from insignificant. And when those feelings come upon you, you need to climb up with your filter and replace your stinking thinking with the idea and the truth that you are not a small thing. Because the Spirit of God lives in your God's habitation, you're a big thing. You're a daughter of the King. You're the temple of the living God. You're his habitation. Christ lives in you. That's big.
Yes, amen.
That's big. Thank you, my two friends up here. What seems small or significant about you is big in the hands of the Almighty God, the God of hosts. Well, Zerubbabel, you know, if you knew his background, and I don't have time to unwrap it, but he was supposed to be the next king. He's from the kingly line. And he had to settle for governor because once the Israelites got back from captivity, there were no more kings. No more kings. But he was of the royal line, and he took the governorship. He was like a civilian ruler, like the mayor of the town, instead of the king. I'm sure it seemed a small thing to him. Just like that temple, look at it. Maybe it's bigger by volume or size or area, but it's not as glorious. And the Bible says God rejoiced over that temple. Why? Because God's power did it. God wasn't rejoicing in the thing itself. God was rejoicing in the fact that he, through his power, inhabited those people. And he did this thing. God is rejoicing over his own work. And when he looks at you, no matter how small you think you are, all God sees is the redeeming work of Jesus and all that he's done to make you the glorious woman that you are. Praise God. That's what he sees. You're greater than Solomon's temple. You're greater than anything. You're a redeemed woman. God looks at you and he says, you're a marvel to me. I rejoice over you. Zephaniah says he sings over you with his love. And I'm telling you, what God rejoices over, you should not despise. So the next time you stand in a mirror and you despise yourself, young lady, look at yourself and say, God rejoices over me. Because it's not by my might, not by my power, but by his spirit, here I stand. The last circumstance when you need your Zechariah 4:6 filter is when you're low on the serving mojo. You ever get low on your serving mojo? This happens a lot. You know when you sign up for things, you know, in September, and you look at your calendar, and it's all clear and clean, every section is empty, and you think, I'll do that, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll do this, I'll do that. I love doing all this stuff, and now it's October. And your little tail feathers are dragging. You know, like, why did I sign up for this? I can't do this anymore. My life, I want to end it. Now you beat yourself up. Now I got involved in too many things. And all that desire to serve and do, what kind of stuff drains out of you? Are you there?
It is October.
This is about when we see people stop coming to things because our priorities have become so crowded that we start to drop things off. And I'm not saying the right or wrong at that. I'm just saying, the truth of that, the observation of that, is that we gather to ourselves so much in the beginning, and then we kind of have to let go of things. The story is told of the settlers when they were going out west to settle the California territory, that they took all of their furniture from Boston and all kind of stuff in the wagons, and the road was littered with furniture. People throw the piano out, throw the couch out, all the stuff you think you need and have to have on the way, all the responsibility, you got to start ditching them out the back of the wagon to make it over the mountains, right? You got to be lean and mean when you've lost your serving mojo. Look at in verse 11. Here's Zechariah because he wants to know what this picture is. He's fascinated by the picture, not just the message. He wants to know what this means. Verse 11, then I asked the angel, what are these two olive trees on the right and the left of the lampstand? Again, I asked him. He's very persistent. He's a prophet. He wants to know. Olive trees don't grow in the temple. You got to at least tell me what they're there for. What are these two olive branches beside the two gold pipes that pour out golden oil? Verse 13, he replied, do you not know what these are? No, my Lord, I said. And verse 14 ends the chapter and says, so he said, these are the two who are anointed by the Lord of all the earth, or to serve the Lord of all the earth. These are the two who are anointed to serve the Lord of all the earth. Literally, the two anointed mean is literally sons of oil. That's what it means, sons of oil. That's what it means. These are two. One is Joshua that we saw last week, and one is Zerubbabel. So we have the priest and we have the king, and they are represented by these olive trees that are bending with all of their oil into this bowl. They're continually, by these pipes connected to the olive trees, they're bending over and pouring, literally, it doesn't even say oil, it says pouring the gold into the bowl that pours into the lamps that gives the light. There's a profusion of oil, a profusion of energy. There's a profusion of mojo in this vision. So when you've lost your serving, What I'm saying to you, the supply hasn't stopped. Somewhere you have stopped receiving the supply. If you could see you, there's a pipe that goes right from the Holy Spirit, right in you, completely and eternally supplying you with the gold. There is never a moment when you don't have the energy to do and to be all that God says you are and calls you to do. Never a moment. So if you're losing or draining or waning, I would say have a conversation with God and say, where am I doing this by my own might, by my own power, when it should be by my Spirit, says the Lord. Of course, this is a picture of Jesus, who is the priest, the high priest. We're going to learn that in Hebrews from Pete. And he's also the King of Kings, our King of Kings, King Jesus. So as you think about this passage, this is what I would love the message to be for you. Surrender the mountain, whatever that is, if that's the part of this message that touched you, surrender that mountain to the Lord. When you get home in your car today in carpool lane, spend that time and surrender that mountain to God. Maybe the smallness piece of this message was what really impacted you. And I'm saying surrender that smallness because it's not who you are. God delights in using small things. But remember, something that's seemingly small in the hand of God is a huge thing. And he rejoices over you. He doesn't see you as small. He sees you as a living, walking miracle of grace. And maybe if you're at the end of your mojo and you just got no mo, then surrender to him. Ask him to show you where you're doing things in your own strength. Ask him, where is that crank in the pipe? I know the oil is flowing, but somehow I don't feel oily. Bottom line is the Spirit dwells in you and wants to do it for you. The Spirit dwells in you and wants to do it for you. Not help you, not partner with you. He wants to do it for you, in you, through you. Father, we love you. We thank you for the sweet and eternal and precious and abundant supply of the Spirit for whatever our need. I pray you would level the mountains. I pray you would help women rejoice in themselves, in their redemption, in the miracle of grace that they are. I pray that as they look in the mirror, they will look at themselves and say, grace, grace, beauty, beauty, glory, glory, because the hand of the Lord has done this. And Lord, for those of us who our strength is waning and we feel like we've signed up for so many things and our life has kind of gobbled up our energy, Lord, would you just show us where perhaps we're trying to minister in our own might and our own power and not by your Spirit, not allowing you to do it for us. Humble us to the place, dear Jesus, where we allow the Spirit of God to do it for us. Remind us often of the words, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. We thank you for your word, and we ask you to remind us of it often today and in the days ahead. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.